now take a step further towards the description of a full instrument with a sensor inside. Congratulations to already passed the, let's say, the optics part of McStas and most of the essential capabilities. And what I'll discuss is a quick reminder of the general concepts when we interact neutrons with samples and MXFAS. And then I'll give you an overview of what we have available. And then I will move to focus on the elastic or diffraction-oriented samples in MXFAS, because we will have dedicated sessions on small angle scattering, for instance, and also on elastic samples, and this will follow tomorrow. So as we discussed in the introduction talks, we have a picture where we think of three processes typically when we when a neutron beam interacts with matter, which is that a neutron can get absorbed, transmitted, or scattered, and via the macroscopic cross sections, we calculate the probabilities of being absorbed and scattered. And then you can say that the transmission is then, in a sense, the risk. And in the McStas formulation of this, what happens is essentially that every array is described as a statistical ensemble of neutrons, and this means that the scattered contribution that goes in a certain direction also contains a macroscopic description of the amount of neutrons that were statistically absorbed in that way, and the same for transmission. Right. So here's a table with different components, and I'll just walk you through it slowly. The ones in bold are the ones we'll actually work with today, which is the power sampling and the single crystal. Among the simplest we have is the incoherent scattering. So, I mean, there is no coherent scattering. It means that what can occur is essentially two things, which is being tunneled through, taking into account absorption, or an isotropic scattering. That's all it does. One step ahead, the power components has a series of bracks, lattices, or a series of back reflections, and produced them by shear cones according to that, and includes incoherent scattering, and includes absorption, and includes a description of, well, the attenuated direct beam. The single crystal, as we'll come back to, has actually a bit more a bit more complicated algorithm inside for the physics. It essentially is a proper reciprocal space construction, and therefore computationally heavy, as you can see and work with today, and includes things like secondary extinction, so you'll actually have an effect of changing the sample size. It's quite a sophisticated piece of kit, and also among the more complex components in MXFAS, I think it has in the order of a few thousand lines of code. And as you saw, the plateau in MXFAS, the typical MXFAS component just has a few hundred lines of code. Isotropic geometry is also reasonably complicated. It says isotropic. It describes isotropic materials, be it powders or liquids, and does both elastic and inelastic scattering. So it takes an input, which is a two-dimensional table in Q and energy, intensity as a function of that. And then by an algorithm taking into account the generalized density of states, it samples that probability table, in a sense. Emmanuel Fahy wrote that. Reasonably complicated. We have a lot of different versions of things that will go on a smaller angle scattering machine. One of the simple ones being sands, spheres. These are monodisperse, meaning all of the same size, particles in a very thin solution. So the assumption is there's no interaction in between these, and you simply get the Fourier transform of that in a sense, in the small angle scattering. So you can reproduce the little ripples that show you what the size distribution looks like. We have a number of models other than that, some that come in a component of their own, meaning cylindrical shapes or a disk of, what's it called, these are nanodisks, for instance. So you have a set of proteins that are packaged within a ring of membrane molecules, so very, very specific things. You can also find them there, as well as SAS fuel models that will actually use most of the available models that you can use in the analysis code called SAS fuel. So they have SAS models, which is a C library, and we simply call their IFQ functions for the scanner. Then we have a few more on the inelastic side. We have a photon in a simple FCC Grammy lattice. And this has, on the other hand, no elastic scattering. So it's a purely inelastic scatterer, which can be kind of confusing if you think there should be a bright peak as well. It will not be there. It's only an inelastic component. And I think MASS has an exercise on that too. Or at least you have a demonstration of how it works. Close to being the same type of component, we also have a magnon lattice. This is a BCC lattice, and it also has no elastic scattering. So this means if you need to describe both, you will actually have to do a kind of combination of the two. Meaning something like the single crystal together with the magnon. Then you will have no elastic scattering, you will have no magnons related to that. Then we have, you may argue it's a new edition, so it's now released with McStas for the first time, which is a development from Duke Lee. I believe he's a Thai. He was in Korea for a while, he's now at ISIS in the UK, and he, in a sense, took isotropic SQ omega, which is the isotropic elastic inelastic solution we have. He generalized that to become a lattice, and then he married that with the single crystals. That's also really a complicated model, and hence really, really slow to use. We are, on the other hand, we are aiming to improve solutions in this area, because this is where we've been lacking methods for a long time. So the case of the inelastic crystalline descriptions is actually the weakest, you may argue, among the different areas we have. What I'm not listing here is a contribution from Rob Dalglish in the UK for reflectometry. So that allows you to describe a set of layers in a multilayer. That actually does the dynamic scattering theory in that. This relies on the GSL, which moves on to the library on your machine. And that is kind of what we offer in reflectometry. Apart from simply using, let's say, the mirror that we saw in play yesterday, together with a reflectivity curve you load from a file. So that's essentially called reflectometry as well. Okay, so there's a more extensive table available, and of course you can't read this at all. So I have done two things. There's a link that you should be able to access here from China. That is meant to be always updated list of McStas central components with a lot of different tables on there. So it has a description of, well, there's a name of the component and the author in there, a short description of what the model is, main areas of use, and then columns of, you see little green and red indicators up there for whether it has incoherent scattering, absorption, elastic scattering, and then what kind, which kind of inelastic scattering it may have, whether it supports multiple scattering, and whether it supports a non-trivial sample geometry. Right. So, going slightly more in depth with the parameters of the sample components, we'll start out briefly touching upon incoherent, which is an incoherent scatter, like you would take your two long instrument to do a benchmark on. So a can of vanadium or a slab of plexi or something like that. And hence it of course has, it of course allows you to describe the geometry. So as usual, you have things like radius and height that you together combine to create a cylinder. Its width and wide height and set depth allows you to do a little box and so forth. This one can, by the way, can be hollow. We'll come back to what this means. So it can contain something inside. We have a keyword called concentric for that. I'll come back to in a few slides what this is in details and how we use it. Then it has something we haven't seen, we've seen in the sources. So you have the concept of focusing, meaning at the source where you produce neutrons that go in 4π. You can direct your neutrons to only illuminate a rectangle on the wall, right? So meaning your beam pole. So this and focus x, w, y height. Many of the samples have a similar concept, and this of course is meant to direct the neutrons towards your detector, because there's not much point in filling the rest of the space with statistics unless you can avoid it. So this is what the target XYZ or target index here. This tells the component where should I roughly point, what's the average direction I should send my things. And then you can combine that with either a circular area, so a radius, or a rectangle around that, which is XWY height here, just like the sources. And finally, there's an angular focusing as well. So around your main direction, a horizontal and a vertical angle. Yes. So as this is a power, in some sense, it's a power that only expresses incoherent scattering. Of course, a proton vanadium also has power lines, as you know. But it means that we have a packing factor introduced here. Yes. And then actually, it can do a little bit of also elastic scattering and other things, but that's kind of an obscure thing. Well, except that it's also, of course, an incoherent process. So this you would use to model something like diffusion for a backscattering machine. That would be one idea. Right. One thing I'll touch upon here more specifically is P interact. So, as you saw in one of the reminder slides, we have three processes that we describe in McStas. We have being scattered, being absorbed, and being transmitted, where absorbed is typically built into the weighting of the transmitted or the scattered beam. P interact here, that allows you to control which fraction of the statistics you will actually scatter incoherently. And that's basically the only kind of scattering you can do with this component. And this means that 1 minus P interact is the remaining statistics in the direct P. One very good reason to be able to control this is actually this concentric keyword that we'll go back to, which allows you to have this in play as a sample container and then have maybe a set of power lines or a single crystal or something else inside. Okay, so among the crystalline samples, well, we of course talking about a range of things from single crystals to powders that have polycrystals or textures or other more complicated material descriptions inside. I believe you have. Do you have something on textures? Everything in the exercise? You actually don't, do you? No. So what we will mainly focus on, if you are particularly interested in, say, engineering oriented materials, we could talk about that later. But what the exercise and the talk will be about essentially is single crystals and powders. And then I'll just give you a teaser that these we do have solutions in this middle range as well. Good. So let's start out with the single crystal model. What we have is a so-called ideally imperfect crystal. It means that we have a peak coordinate. It's not the reflection is not a Dirac delta peak. We have a Gaussian broadening, which is dominated by mosaic, meaning the distribution of orientations around the main crystal lattice. So we assume, in other words, that each of these little crystallites are perfect, and then we have a kind of Gaussian smearing on that orientation. So space group symmetries. Eric, what was the point of this exact line here?
It's considered our scope.
Yes.
You have to know what your space group of your crystal is to begin with. It's not figured out by.
So you may say that the algorithm here doesn't actually know anything about crystallography as such. You provide a file name that contains the specification of the lattice. It's not that we call something like a chrysophemil or another kind of crystallography lattice to give you a space group FM3 dash something, because we have to serve the community of users across disciplines, so we couldn't go about implementing a full crystallography solution for you here. Maybe that's it. Is that fair to say?
Yes.
But there's a solution, as you can see, and we use it to describe any kind of space group, of course. It's essentially written for physicists, simple unit cells, so a few different atoms. But it doesn't mean that it doesn't work for crazy things like macromolecules. There are some specific issues in trying to do that. We'll come back to a little bit what they are. But it turns out it works. So there's no assumption about the unit cell orientation, etc. And there's a Gaussian model for the mosaic. In the inputs, you already see that this is getting really long and hard to read. If I go over here, I have a chance to read myself. So you have different things talking about mosaic. We'll come back to what these are. You, of course, have, as usual, a description of the geometry, meaning the possibility of assuming a spherical or a cylindrical or a box shape, etc. Then there's a new thing here, which is reflections. And that's a file name that contains the structure factors for the reflections. So that's essentially a list of the reflections we will describe in this material. And it, by the way, also includes many of the other things that you can set here. So things like what is what is the value of my sigma apps and sigma incoherent. Typically, this is something that you give in the file. So essentially, what you do to describe the single crystal is you put the file, and then you can add further things. You have to enrich by, let's say, yeah, so density over the lattice space variation and mosaic. We'll come back to how these are used in the algorithm. And then you can also give the orientation of the lattice here. Let's say we have 9 parameters, A, X, Y, Z, B, X, Y, Z, C, X, Y, Z. And this can give you an orientation of the lattice in freeform 3D space as it occurs in McStas. So it's a kind of, you may argue it's an internal goniometer of the box of the sample where you orient the lattice with respect to your instrument. So this means that you can have a crystal which is not cut along the main axis. Good. So as before, we also have something for specifying statistics. Here it's a p-transmit. So it allows you to say, I would like 50%. I don't know why you want that, but 50% of my beam should only be attenuated according to the cross section, but remain on the main beam. You might have a reason to do that. Yes. So, for instance, in the case of a single crystal sapphire sample container or something like that, that you put something over inside, and this means that whatever is tunneled through, you would like to assign a good statistics to. So this gives you a handle on what your interest is. Good. So this internal goniometer here, that can be specified both for the direct and the reciprocal lattice of the crystal. What else? Yeah, there are some the main angles of the system here as well. And that's because you could also specify the lattice that way. Yeah. You may have a curvature that's kind of specific, and I'm not sure how well it actually works, but the idea would be that you use this as an approximation for something like a bent silicon,
yep,
or or equivalent, so it's mostly for the optics side, I would say.
Yeah. If you have a bent crystal, then and it's not very bent. It's an approximation that the bending angles are pretty small, yeah, so you don't have drift in the crystal.
Yeah. Then you have a couple of options here at the end that are kind of esoteric, but interesting enough. So this is a single crystal, and of course if the orientation is suddenly random, it becomes a power. So you can use it to model a power. That being said, you have to, well, to really express the proper power lines, etc. You have to play with mosaicities. It's among the not so tested options of this component. Also, there's the possibility of using this to model a parametric graphite. So this means that the crystal is oriented on the main axis, but you have the random orientation that you would have in a parametric graphite. So it's more of a physics model for parametric graphite than what you saw in one of the main flat curves. Good? Yeah. Yeah, so this is actually kind of repeating what I just said. You have unit cell vectors that encodes the crystal orientation relative to the component orientation or instrument orientation. You have different parameters for mosaicity here. Good. So, what this algorithm does is that it given the KI of an arbitrary neutron. I mean, there's no assumption on the entry direction on the lattice of the incoming neutron. It is not there. So, given what this neutron arrives with, we lay out the reciprocal space, we do the eval construction, and then we look which of the reflections are within reach the evil circle. And then, of course, if we kept, let's say, the Dirac delta function nature of the reflections, we would have very little chance of hitting anything. Right? And this is why a mosaicity is introduced. And this mosaicity simply defines a cigar shape, an ellipsoidal reciprocal space. So the shorter, so you see you have your, you have a Ki and you have a Kf here. So that is your, that is the reflection which is in play here. So delta D over D, that's is the variation or the width along time. And the mosaicities that you can otherwise specify is then around that direction. And what then happened is that we do a couple of Monte Carlo choices to choose according to these Gaussian delta D over D mosaicity distributions a Kf. So this will give you a small spread on the Kf. As you can see, there's already a lot of calculation to initialize reciprocal space in this way and calculate the probabilities, etc. And this is done for every neutron. So this is why it can be quite heavy component to run. Yes, so in terms of mosaicity, there are three models. I'll touch upon them briefly here. Eric is the expert, he's the geek in McStas with regard to mosaicity. So historically, what we have been using, and what is that, is an isotropic mosaicity. It's assumed that mosaicity is has no preferred orientation with regards to the lattice. And that, I should say, is what most people just use this component for. There's also the possibility of giving an isotropic mosaicity. This means that you do Gaussian distributions that are different around the angles of the unit cell axis. So both of these are in some sense microscopic. It's not what you would go and measure as a mosaicity on your instrument. So it really is what type of Monte Carlo choice should I do here? What's the range in the microstructure of the crystal at the actual scattering position of the crystal? The third one, that is indeed more of more related to what you would measure at the instruments. That's a kind of rocking curve mosaic, a Gaussian distribution around an axis determined by the width of two given back peaks. So you need to specify you need to specify sigma and HKL for these two peaks. And this then gives you, this instead gives you then the mosaicity. But the rest of the algorithm is the same. It's simply, you can say the extent and reciprocal space of this Gaussian episode. Good. Right. So that is on single crystal for now. The power is essentially an implementation of a textbook set of equations for powers. So it means that we find the relevant cross section given the F square of a reflection, and this is what we normalize onto a function. So that is in an algorithmic sense much more simple. But one thing I should mention also about the single crystal is that it has, in principle, of course not infinite, but multiple scattering in there according to the physics. So whenever a scattering occurs, there's still the possibility of scattering the outgoing ray. And let's say the probabilistic approach to that, there is, you can suppress it if you want. That's confusing. I'm talking about power n, single crystal still. So power n, aiming at describing differences of the two. So single crystal has multiple scattering, power n does actually not. The inputs to power N are of course similar, but simpler. So there is a reflection list that you specify again. Which are the lattice planes that can scatter here? What this the f squared, etc. For the given reflection, you can specify geometry, all the things that normalizes your scattering. So things like padding factor, units of volume here, cross sections. Again, things that are read from the file, if it exists in the file. And then you have a handle here to suppress that or change that if you wish. There is actually a lattice space variation that we can introduce here. And again, we have the possibility here of normalizing the statistics, meaning what fraction of the statistics do we assign to the device electrons, the incoherent scattering, and the transmitted beam. Of course, they have to sum up to one. So this means here that this one has, it actually have handles for all of them, and I'm sure you'll get a warning in a moment that you actually know that it sums to one. Anyway. This has also the possibility of assuming a concentric shape. We'll talk more deeply about that in a second. Other physical quantities like density and weight, etc. Yes. So these sampling parameters, controlling the statistics, I'll talk about that. And then the concentricity we will actually discuss now. So imagine you have the situation that you have a sample container with a sample inside, or you have some material with another material inside. And as you have probably seen from this, we are always talking about one material at a time. So there's no way of doing this within one component. So in principle, what we do in McStas is that we disassemble this construction of the possibility of scattering on, let's say, the sample environment, then scattering on the sample, and scattering again on the sample environment. This is done by a trick. It's called concentric. And essentially, given the direction of the incoming neutron, we then only, once the concentric flag is raised here, we then only consider the part of the sample which is accessible from, let's say, the outside here, and then propagate at maximum to this inner hollow here. Okay, so we have a first version of, let's say, the sample environment. Then we introduce a sample inside, so we do normal scattering on that. And then we introduce what is in fact a copy of this one. So the moment you realize this encoding McStas, you will actually have the sample environment, then the sample, and then the sample environment again. Because then the neutron with the linear flow of McStas has a chance to revisit the sample environment. And here, of course, again, given the direction of the neutron that was scattered in the sample, only the part which is, let's say, physically accessible by the neutron is what we do the calculations for. Right. So in code, it looks something like that. So we have, let's say, an aluminum container around here. You specify the reflection list, that's aluminum.glass here. We make it a cylinder, so 2 centimeters in radius, and a height of 5 centimeters. And a thickness of 5 millimeters. So I don't. Yeah, that's probably hard. Well, the drawing is not too scale here, I should say. So the thickness is indeed what describes then how much material is available. So this means the inner radius here is radius minus thickness. Then This is also where the statistics normalization parameters come in with a quite an importance, because if you are to scatter on anything which is inside here, you better have a reasonable description statistically of your attenuated bi-weak beam. So you do want to scatter on break lines here, but probably you also want to still illuminate what is your main direction of the direct beam. So here I'm assigning 80%, actually. So I'm only assigning 20% to the things that scatter on my sample environment, and most of it will actually go directly to my sample in an attenuated form. But I have both channels, both branches in the algorithm. So I can actually have a thing like this with scattering on a power line up here. Then we introduce, so there's so this was on the aluminum. That's an aluminum calcite, I guess, the aluminum. Anyway, I can't remember the exact name of the compound here, but we have another powder which is packed inside that then fills. So this I guess is not also completely corresponding to the drawing, but the idea would be that it either fills or it sits inside the hollow of the sample environment. And there's a control on the statistics here, so 15% will go in the incoherent scattering from the sample, 50% still will be channeled through with the possibility of scattering on the sample environment without actually changing direction in the sample, so meaning the transmit beam. So the remainder goes to the elastic scattering. And then you see another of the advanced grammar keywords here. You see a copy which is being introduced here. And what copy means is simply this component here called AL2 should be the same as AS1. So AL2 should be the same as AL. But actually then we override one of these. So concentric here is what in some sense takes away material at the end here, and this we then override by concentric equals zero. So you can say that it's a copy with all the parameters here, and then you have the possibility of overriding some of them in the second set of parentheses. So that's also very a very strong keyword for the let's say simplifying the grammar of your instrument file. If you have multiple things that are exactly the same, or very close to the same, this allows you to compactify a bit of text. Then, for the focusing part, PowerN has a D5 and also a focus flip here. And these are to suppress the otherwise scattering into 4π. So this, what you would use this for, so on a given bit by share of home here, what you would use this for is to only illuminate your detector, let's say your banana shape detector on the power sample. Not to describe the part of the bi-shadow cone that will go to the bottom and at the top of your experimental form. So it enhances the statistics that will actually go to your detector. And as I remember, it is the... Is it the full or the half angle?
It's the full.
It's the full angle.
Yeah.
Full. So you do a calculation of, at the given geometry of my detector, What is the angle that I should spend? Yes. And then I focus flip allows you to do that vertically instead of horizontally. Good. So for the inputs, we refer to them all actually as reflection lists, but there's a header in the top. That specifies things like values of the cross section or density or whatever. And maybe this will actually be less abstract the moment you have a look in the files. They are all human readable text, and you should always, whether it is then completely correct in all cases, I cannot ensure, but typically there's a reference here to an experiment, so you will be able to refine where we got this reflection is from. Space loop, what atoms are in there, so essentially the kind of information you would have in a crystallography database is typically just pasted directly in, and then from physical parameters and downward is what we may take and use in a McStas sample algorithm. And these, the ones that have a suffix of lao, will list all independent reflections, meaning it'll actually also list symmetries. And that's important, especially for the single crystal, because it doesn't, as you saw, it doesn't have any crystallography as such. It needs equivalent reflections listed explicitly. So that is what is in the LAO data files. You will find both 111 and -111 and so forth. All combinations need to be listed explicitly. And this can be used with the single crystal as well as the power N and isotropic espirometer. The latter ones will of course use this to form a power, because the models are isotropic. Good. For use with power N and isotropic espirometer, you have a similar data file, so supplementing the LAO file, you also have a LAS. And this is simpler, simply a more compact specification of the reflections. So the multiples are not listed equivalently, but essentially the same type of information is available. The formatting and the units of the different columns in the file are slightly different. But the main thing is this one does not work properly with the same crystal. Good. So there is a number of materials, and I think it might be slightly out of date, but it gives you a rough idea. So we really have a lot of powers. We have fewer single crystals, but many materials that are relevant, especially in the small molecule end of things. There are a couple of macro molecules here. Rubidoxin and it's pre-deuterated pyrophosphates, which is a protein of some kind that was deuterated. So this is for describing protein crystallography. So this is also available in there. So these files can be accessed either directly from your McStas data folder. So on Windows, you find this within McStas 2.5 lib data. On Linux, you find it where your McStas is, 2.5 and data, and the same on the Mac. You also have the possibility to construct your own. And one of the easiest ways of doing that, if you have access to a crystallography database, this could be ICSD, or the crystallography open database, or if you can build one like with a software like Vesta. So if you can find a SIF file, there's a utility included with your McStas called SIF2HKO that will then take the information from the SIF file, apply the specified radiation, so be it neutrons or X-rays at a given wavelength, and then generate this reflection list for you. And it says, the assumption is that if you don't specify the radiation, it will be neutrons. I should also say that for X-rays, we know there are some bugs, right? So some of the calculations are not completely right. But Emmanuel Farr, who made this utility, is now moving to X-rays. So I guess that would be improved shortly. That's our idea. But in principle, all you do is you take your SIF file and you indicate that it should be a powder, and then you get the type of file which is useful for the powders. And there's a similar syntax to generate the single crystal list. So that's simply SIF to HKL minus minus crystal file.sif, and then you get the LAO file that's compatible with the single crystal. Good. So we have a number of other input files that you will also find if you look in the data directory. I think we'll not talk a lot about these, but the two-dimensional tables for isotropic is geometer, omega, so intensity as function of Q modulus and energy. These are found. Q as Q here, that is a similar format for the structure of liquids that also goes to isotropic S geometry. We have a sample from Mirko Boyn in Helmholtz Zentrum Berlin, which is called sample annexes, and that actually has a bit of, a crystallography algorithm in there. So you can specify a unit cell with atom, positions. And then it will actually internally do, I think it's not a single crystal, I think it's spanning the range of textures to powders or something like that. That's my, as I remember it, that's what it's using. No, so there's no need.